Hey folks, this is Shock, and I had a pretty good idea. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to see if I can read the entire New Testament. I'm going to break it up into different parts, like the Gospel of Mark, John, etc., like that. And I've had some requests to actually read the Bible, and you guys have said you really enjoyed it. Even some of you that don't really spend a lot of time reading the Bible, I like to read the Bible to you guys, and then we'll stop and we'll talk about certain parts in the scriptures. So it's a lot of fun, and it's definitely not boring. If you can stick with me for like 5 minutes or so, I think you'll be hooked on these Bible studies. And what I'm going to do, we're going to see if we can make this like a little project where I can take the time to record these Bible studies. I have the Bible in front of me, as you can see on the page. I'm moving the web browser up and down there, and we'll go through it. So we're going to start off with the book of Mark. Now, most folks believe that the Gospel of Mark was likely the first of the four Testament Gospels to be written. And we know that it was composed before the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70. It is not a first-hand account, but rather comes to us through the lens of other apostles, especially Peter. Now, some scholars think Mark might have been the unidentified young man who ran away at Jesus' arrest in 1451. So remember that. Mark 14:51. I'm going to be reading that part. Some people believe that. Hold on, let me get my headset ready here. I'm on the headset microphone I got on here. Some people believe that was Mark. Now, Mark does not record many of Jesus' sermons, but instead, what he does is he emphasizes what Jesus did more than what he said. And his gospel does not dwell on Jesus' family, history, or ministry, but records his achievements. And they are pretty action-packed from beginning to end. Now, what you're going to find as I go through Mark is similar to like a reporter with an almost breathless quality about the writing. Now, it's almost as if you are there seeing and hearing everything as it happens. You could call it the gospel for busy people. Now, what you're going to find is one of Mark's favorite words is immediately. He uses this word 42 times. He also uses the historical present tense 150 times, such as Jesus comes, Jesus says, Jesus heals, and he portrays Christ's life is extremely busy and even having trouble finding time to eat, as you'll hear in 3:20 and 6:31. What Mark emphasizes is the servanthood of Christ, showing Christ healing the sick, raising the dead, and feeding the hungry. His works provide a compelling argument for salvation because they show powerfully the incredible love of God for you and I. And because of God's love and grace, Mark invites us to run into the arms of our Father, and then he points us to Jesus as the perfect example of how we should live. Now, Mark's version of Jesus' ministry is a simple, direct, and easy to understand manual for our salvation and spiritual transformation. So, you're going to find as I go through this, it's like a beautiful collection of parables, miracles, teachings. And Mark definitely is foundational to understanding the words of Christ that we find in the other gospels. So let's begin. You guys ready? Now I got my coffee here. Let me take a sip. So let's do this. I've never done this before. My goal is I'm going to go through the whole Gospel of Mark here, and then we'll see if we can do some other gospels also and other parts of the Bible. The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophets, behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. John did baptize in the wilderness and preach the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. And there went out unto him all the land of Judea, and they of Jerusalem, and were all baptized of him in the river of Jordan, confessing their sins. So they're talking about John the Baptist and his baptizing of the people. And John was clothed with camel's hair and with the girdle of a skin about his loins, and he did eat locust and wild honey, and preached, saying, "There cometh one mightier than I after me, the latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to stoop down and unloose." So John's basically getting people prepared for Jesus Christ. John says, "I indeed have baptized you with water, but he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost." And it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized of John in Jordan. And straightway coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens open and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. And I want it to be known, you notice it says the Spirit like a dove. So sometimes people will say it was a dove. Notice it says like a dove. It could be resembling a dove or something like that. And it says in the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. And there came a voice from heaven saying, "Thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." And immediately the Spirit driveth him into the wilderness. So Jesus goes into the wilderness. And he was there in the wilderness 40 days, tempted of Satan, and was with the wild beast, and the angels ministered unto him. Now, after John was put into prison, let me scroll down here. Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent ye and believe in the gospel." Now, as he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishers. And Jesus said unto them, "Come ye after me, and I will make you to become fishers of men." And straightway they forsook their nets and followed him. And when he had gone a little farther thence, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who also were in the ship mending their nets. So picture this, Jesus is walking along the shores of the sea here, and there's these fishermen there, and he tells them to come follow him. What some biblical scholars believe, guys, if I just stop here, it's they believe that these fishermen had heard of Jesus Christ, and so when Jesus comes onto the scene, it's not like he's just some total stranger and he says, "Hey, follow me," and then they all just drop what they're doing. What some scholars, and I'll leave this up to you for you to decide, what some scholars believe is that they had already heard of Jesus Christ. They didn't know him personally, but they had heard of him and knew who he was. And when Jesus comes walking by and he tells them to follow him, this is why they do it. I'll let you decide for yourself. And straightway he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the ship with the hired servants and went after him. And when they went into Capernaum, and straightway on the Sabbath day he entered into the synagogue and taught. And they were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one that had authority and not as the scribes. And there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, saying, "Let us alone. What have we to do with thee, thou Jesus of Nazareth? Art thou come to destroy us?" Now, when you first read this, you see that this man is yelling out at Jesus Christ, but basically the man's demon possessed. And it is pretty interesting that it seems to me that the demons know the end, their end fate. Why are they the demons kind of freaking out here? And he says to Jesus, "Have you come to destroy us?" And they say, "I know thee who thou art, the Holy One of God." And Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Hold thy peace and come out of him." And when the unclean spirit had torn him and cried with a loud voice, he came out of him. And they were all amazed, insomuch that they questioned among themselves, saying, "What thing is this? What new doctrine is this? For with authority commandeth he even the unclean spirits, and they do obey him. And immediately, there's the word I was telling you about that Mark uses a lot. And immediately, his fame spread throughout all the region round about Galilee. And forthwith, when they were come out of the synagogue, they entered into the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. But Simon's wife's mother lay sick, so I guess that's his mother-in-law, right? Simon's wife's mother lay sick of a fever, and then they tell him of her, and he came and took her by the hand and lifted her up, and immediately the fever left her, and she ministered unto them. And at even, when the sun did set, they brought unto him all that were diseased and them that were possessed with devils, and all the city was gathered together at the door, and he healed many that were sick of diverse diseases, and cast out many devils, and suffered not the devils to speak, because they knew him. And in the morning, rising up a great while before day, he went out and departed into a solitary place, and there prayed. And Simon and they that were with him followed after him. And when they found him, they said unto him, all men seek for thee. Basically, they're telling Jesus, look, everyone's looking for you. And he said unto them, let us go into the next towns, that I may preach there also, for therefore came I forth. In other words, he's saying, this is the reason why I'm here, you know, to preach to them also. And he preached in their synagogues throughout all Galilee, and cast out devils. And there came a leper to him, beseeching him, and kneeling down to him, and saying to him, if thou wilt, thou canst make me clean. And Jesus, moved with compassion, put forth his hand and touched him, and saith unto him, I will, be thou clean. And as soon as he had spoken, here it is again, immediately the leprosy departed from him, and he was cleansed. And he straightly charged him, and forthwith sent him away, and saith unto him, see, this is what Jesus tells the leper, the ex-leper, I should say, see thou say nothing to any man, but go thy way, shew thyself to the priest, and offer for thy cleansing those things which Moses commanded for a testimony unto them. Now, what the guy can't, he can't keep it a secret. It says, but he went out and began to publish it much, and to blaze abroad the matter, insomuch that Jesus could no more, could no more openly enter into the city, but was without in desert places, and they came to him from every quarter. So they're basically, he can't go anywhere. They're just swarming him. Everyone wants to be near him and be blessed by him. And again, he entered into Capernaum after some days, and it was noised that he was in the house. And straightway, many were gathered together, insomuch that there was no room to receive them. No, not so much as about the door. So basically, he's in the house and it's packed. I mean, standing room only, people in there, sardines, like sardines. And they come unto him, bringing one sick of the palsy, which was born of four. And so basically, these guys are carrying let the passage read it here. And when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was. And when they had broken it up, they let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. So you get that? Basically, this guy's, you know, sick, and he's lying on this, I guess you call it like a cot or whatever, and they can't get to Jesus. So they're like, well, we'll just go ahead and we'll just rip the roof off. So picture this. It's epic when you really think about it. Jesus is looking up and the pieces of the roof are falling down. And here comes this guy being dropped, you know, as they're bringing him down right in front of Jesus. I bet that was a sight. When Jesus saw their faith, notice Jesus is pleased with that. He said unto the sick of the palsy, son, thy sins be forgiven thee. Now, when he says that, there's an issue here with some of the quote unquote religious people. And I want to stop a second and talk to you about this here. Some of the things that cause people to become atheists, I used to be an atheist myself, is like religious hypocrisy and things like that. And I understand that. I won't name any type of churches or anything or that have this hypocrisy, but this is why I think when someone that's an atheist like I was reads about Jesus Christ, he's so intriguing. He fulfills everything that I think, or at least me, atheists like me, thirsted for, which was, non-hypocrisy, truth. And well, let me just go through this. Watch this. So Jesus just heals the guy, right? But the religious folks, actually, it's the religious folks. He says, they say to him, there were certain of the scribes sitting there and reasoning in their hearts. They said, "Why does this man speak blasphemies?" Now, they then say, "Who can forgive sins but God only?" Now, they're right about that, aren't they? So watch what Jesus says. And immediately when Jesus perceived in his spirit that they so reasoned with themselves, he said unto them, "Why reason ye things in your these things in your heart? Whether it is easier to say to the sick of the palsy, thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, arise and take up thy bed and walk." And Jesus, he's right. He's like, basically, look, anyone can say, "Oh, your sins are forgiven thee." Anyone can say that. But what's more difficult is actually to heal the person. And here Jesus has done the more difficult thing. Rather than just saying verbal words, he's actually healed the person. So, in other words, Jesus is showing that he can back up what he's saying. And that's why Jesus says, "Why reason ye these things in your hearts, whether it is easier to say to the sick of the palsy, thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, arise and take up thy bed and walk?" In other words, which one's more difficult? Of course, it's to say, arise and take up thy bed and walk. But then Jesus says, "But that you may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins," he says to the sick of the palsy, "I say unto thee, arise and take up thy bed and go thy way into thine house." And immediately he rose, took up the bed, and went forth before them all, insomuch that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, "We never saw it on this fashion." And he went forth again by the seaside, and all the multitude resorted unto him, and he taught them. And as he passed by, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, these names, guys, I'm telling you, bear with me, sitting at the receipt of custom, and said unto him, "Follow me." And he arose and followed him. And it came to pass that as Jesus sat at meat in his house, many publicans and sinners sat also together with Jesus and his disciples, for there were many, and they followed him. And when the scribes and Pharisees saw him eat with publicans and sinners, they said unto his disciples, "How is it that he eateth and drinketh with publicans and sinners?" Now, when Jesus heard it, he saith unto them, "They that are whole have no need of the physician, but they that are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." And the disciples of John and of the Pharisees used to fast, and they come and say unto him, "Why do the disciples of John and the Pharisees fast, but the disciples fast not?" And Jesus said unto them, "Can the children of the bride chamber fast while the bridegroom is with them? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. But the days will come when the bridegroom shall be taken away from them, and then shall they fast in those days. No man also seweth a piece of new cloth on an old garment, else the new piece that filled it up taketh it away from the old, and the rent is made worse. And no man putteth new wine into old bottles, else the new wine doth burst the bottles, and the wine is spilled, and the bottles will be marred. But new wine must be put into new bottles." And it came to pass that he went through the cornfields on the Sabbath day, and his disciples began, as they went, to pluck the ears of corn. And the Pharisees said unto him, Behold, why do they on the Sabbath day that which is not lawful? And he said unto them, Have you never read what David did when he had need and was hungered, he and they that were with him, how he went into the house of God in the days of Abiathar the high priest, and did eat the showbread, which is not lawful to eat, but for the priest, and gave also them which were with him? And this is really true. He said, the Sabbath was made for man, and not man for the Sabbath. In other words, he's saying the Sabbath is a good thing. Therefore, the Son of Man is Lord also of the Sabbath. Let's take a coffee break here. Hold on a second. Okay. And he entered again into the synagogue, and there was a man there which had a withered hand. And they watched him, whether he would heal him on the Sabbath day, that they might accuse him. And he saith unto the man which had the withered hand, Stand forth. And he saith unto them, Is it lawful to do good on the Sabbath days, or to do evil, to save life, or to kill? But they held their peace. And when he had looked around about on them with anger, being grieved for the hardness of their hearts, he saith unto the man, Stretch forth thine hand. And he stretched it out, and his hand was restored whole as the other. And the Pharisees went forth, and straightway took counsel with the Herodians against him, how they might destroy him. But Jesus withdrew himself with his disciples to the sea, and a great multitude from Galilee followed him, and from Judea, and from Jerusalem, and from Idumea, and from beyond Jordan, all these places, Tyre and Sidon. A great multitude, when they heard what great things he did, came unto him, and he spake to his disciples that a small ship should wait on him because of the multitude, lest they should throng him. So his plan is to get a small ship, and then maybe he could teach them from the water while all the people are on the shore. Okay. Now, for he had healed many, insomuch that they pressed upon him for to touch him, as many as had plagues and unclean spirits, when they saw him, fell down before him and cried, saying, Thou art the Son of God. So basically, these people that are demon-possessed are falling down in front of him, proclaiming, Thou art the Son of God. I mean, that must have been epic to behold that. And he straitly charged them that they should not make him known. And he goeth up into a mountain and calleth unto him whom he would, and they came unto him. And he ordained 12 that they should be with him, and that he might send them forth to preach, and to have power to heal sicknesses, and to cast out devils. And Simon, he surnamed Peter, and James the son of Zebedee, and John the brother of James, and he surnamed them Boanerys, which is the sons of thunder. That's a cool name. And Andrew, and Philip, and Bartholomew, and Matthew, and Thomas, and James the son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, and Simon the Canaanite, and Judas Iscariot, which also betrayed him, and they went into a house. And the multitude cometh together again, so they could not so much as eat bread, so they only have time to eat, because everyone's just flocking around Jesus Christ. And when his friends heard of it, they went out to lay hold on him, for they said, He is beside himself. Now you notice what it says, and when his friends heard of it, they went to lay hold on him, for they said he is beside himself. They're talking about Jesus Christ. Well, you can see why his friends would say that. The people are flocking to Jesus Christ. You got these people that are demon-possessed falling on the ground, yelling, you know. Everywhere he's going, it's like a madhouse. People are just trying to get to him and stuff because of his power. So imagine if you saw Jesus there and he's walking by all these people and demons are yelling and people are standing up praising God and you got all this commotion. It was probably unusual to see. You haven't seen that before. So it says, and when his friends heard of it, they went out to lay hold on him, for they said he's beside himself. And the scribes which came down from Jerusalem said, now they started accusing Jesus Christ of really blasphemy. They're basically saying blasphemy here. They're saying he hath Beelzebub, and by the prince of devils casteth he out devils. So here you have the religious people, believe it or not, saying to Jesus, oh, well, you're using the power of Satan to do this. And Jesus called them, and he called them unto him and said unto them in parables, how can Satan cast out Satan? In other words, like, that's so stupid. I mean, why would you say Satan would be destroying himself? I mean, come on. And if a kingdom be divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house be divided against itself, that house cannot stand. Excuse me. And if Satan rise up against himself and be divided, he cannot stand, but hath an end. No man can enter into a strong man's house and spoil his goods, except he will first bind the strong man, and then he will spoil his house. Verily I say unto you, now, this is a key phrase here. When Jesus says this, it's sort of like modern slang for, like, hey, you can take this to the bank. Hey, this is truth. You can count on it. It's 100% true. It's reliable. That's what this means. Verily I say unto you, all sins shall be forgiven unto the sons of men, and blasphemies wherewith soever they shall blaspheme. So Jesus is saying, you blaspheme, okay, you could be even forgiven of that. But notice he said, but he that shall blaspheme against the Holy Ghost hath never forgiveness, but is in danger of eternal damnation. Well, what's he saying that for? Well, what were the scribes, what were they just saying over here? You notice they were saying, he hath Beelzebub, and by the prince of devils casteth out he out devils. So they're basically, they're getting close to being in danger of eternal damnation if they really are claiming that. That's why Jesus says, look, if you blaspheme the Holy Ghost, your sins will never be forgiven. But they said, notice they just ignore him, he has an unclean spirit. Now they're saying Jesus is demon possessed. There came then his brethren and his mother, and standing without, sent unto him, calling him. So the parents and his brethren are trying to get to him, his mom's trying to get to him, I should say, and his brethren. And the multitude sat about him, and they said unto him, behold, thy mother and thy brethren without seek for thee. In other words, they're outside, they're asking for you. And Jesus answered them. He answered them, saying, who is my mother or my brethren? And he looked round about on which sat about him and said, behold, my mother, my brethren. For whosoever shall do the will of God, the same is my brother and my sister and my mother. And he began again to teach by the seaside. And there was gathered unto him a great multitude, so that he entered into a ship and sat in the sea. And the whole multitude was on the sea, was by the sea on the land, and he taught them many things by parables, and said unto them in his doctrine, hearken, behold. Now this, what he says here, if someone said, if you only had like 5 minutes to really explain the gospel to people, this is something I would definitely bring up. This is important. And let's see if you guys get this, okay? Because he uses parables. Jesus says, behold, there went out a sower to sow, someone that plants seed. And it came to pass, as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and the fowls of the air came and devoured it up. And some fell on stony ground, where it had not much earth, and immediately it sprang up, because it had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, it was scorched, and because it had no root, it withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no fruit. And another fell on good ground and did yield fruit that sprang up and increased and brought forth some 30 and some 60 and some 100. And he said unto them, He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. In other words, this is important. Pay attention. And when he was alone, they that were about him with the 12 asked him of the parable. They didn't get it. You see, like they're like, now what is it now? You know? And he said unto them, Unto you it is given to know the mystery of the kingdom of God, but unto them that are without, all these things are done in parables. Now, this is really interesting. This is like a little mystery here that you guys should study. Jesus says that seeing they may see and not perceive. In other words, they're looking right at it, but they don't see it. And hearing they may hear and not understand, lest at any time they should be converted and their sin should be forgiven them. And he said unto them, Know ye not this parable? And how then will you know all parables? In other words, this is a key. This is the key to understanding it. That's why he says, you know, basically, if you don't know this parable, you're not going to understand anything else. This is a key right here. Know ye not this parable? And how then will you know all parables? Now he defines it for us. Now, as we go through this, please don't be offended with me. As we go through this, put a mirror in front of your face, sort of spiritually, and let's see where you stand among these examples in this parable. Be brutally honest with yourself and ask yourself where you stand here. Here we go. The sower soweth the word. And these are they by the wayside where the word is sown. He's talking about the word of God, the gospel of Jesus Christ. But when they have heard, these are people that have heard the word, Satan comes immediately and takes away the word that was sown in their hearts. And these are they likewise which are sown on stony ground, who when they have heard the word, they hear the gospel Jesus Christ is talking about, they immediately receive it with gladness and have no root in themselves, and so endure but for a time. You know, someone makes fun of them, or they get, you know, something happens that they're just not rooted and grounded in God's word. The cares of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, etc., you know, gets to them. Popularity, whatever. Afterward, Jesus says, when affliction or persecution arises for the word's sake, in other words, people making fun of you or whatever, immediately they are offended. And these are they which are sown among thorns, such as hear the word. And the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches and the lust of other things entering in choke the word, and it becometh unfruitful. And these are they which, now this is the one that I hope you and I subscribe to. And these are they which are sown on good ground, such as hear the word and receive it and bring forth fruit, some 30-fold, some 60, and some 100. And he said unto them, Is a candle brought to be put under a bushel or under a bed, and not to be set on a candlestick? For there is nothing hid which shall not be manifested, neither was anything kept secret, but that it should come abroad. If any man have ears to hear, let him hear. And he said unto them, Take heed what you hear, with what measure you meet, it shall be measured to you, and unto you that you hear shall be more be given. For he that hath, to him shall be given, and he that hath not, from him shall be taken even that which he hath. And he said, So is the kingdom of God, as if a man should cast seed into the ground, and should sleep, and rise night and day, and the seed should spring and grow up, he knoweth not how. For the earth bringeth forth fruit of herself, first the blade, then the ear, after that the full corn in the ear. But when the fruit is brought forth, immediately he putteth in the sickle, because the harvest is come. And he said, Okay, where were we? Okay, whereunto shall we liken the kingdom of God? Or with what comparison shall we compare it? It is like a grain of mustard seed, which when it is sown in the earth is less than all the seeds that be in the earth. But when it is sown, it groweth up and becometh greater than all the herbs and shoot out great branches, so that the fowls of the air may lodge under the shadow of it. This is another secret message here. If you guys actually figure out what that means, it'll blow your mind. I'm not going to tell you. Well, if you email me, I'll tell you. But see if you can figure out yourself. Jesus says, it blew my mind when I found out what it was. When the seed is grown, it grows up, becomes greater than all herbs, and shooteth out great branches, so that the fowls of the air may lodge under the shadow of it. And with many such parables spake he the word unto them as they were able to hear it. So this is the key here, that the fowls of the air may lodge under the shadow of it. But without a parable speak he not unto them. And when they were alone, he expounded all things to his disciples. And the same day when the even was come, he saith unto them, now this is something else to kind of pay attention here, guys. Jesus says, let us pass over unto the other side. Remember that, okay? Let us pass over unto the other side. And when they had sent away the multitude, they took him even as he was in the ship. So they all get in the ship, right? What are they going to do? Remember? The other side. They're going to go to the other side. And there were also with him other little ships. And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship so that it was now full. So it's basically filling up with water. And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow. And they awake him and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish? Like, in other words, wake up, don't you even care that we're going through all this? And he arose and rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said unto them, Why are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? Now, when you first read that, you're like, What? You're like, Well, how could Jesus say, Why are you so fearful? I mean, what about the waves and and it's filling up with water? And then Jesus says, How is it you have no faith? Well, look what he said. Remember? Let us pass over unto the other side. Once Jesus says, hey, we're going to go over to the other side, you ain't going to go under. Once he says this, let us pass over, there's no way you're going to go under. This is why he says, why are you so fearful? I said, let us pass over into the other side, see? You have nothing to worry about. And they feared exceedingly. Now, they're not afraid anymore of the waves and everything. They're respecting his power, guys. They feared exceedingly and said one to another, What manner of man is this that even the wind and the sea obey him? Mark 5. Let's take a coffee sip break here. Hold on. It's really cold over here in California tonight, and my coffee's just now it's cold because I haven't been drinking. But not to leave you guys in suspense. And they came over into the other side of the sea, into the country of the Gadarene. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately, here we go again, there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. Now, this is kind of bizarre. Check this out. Who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no man could bind him. So this guy's got like very almost superhuman strength, like. No, not with chains, because that he had been often bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces, nor could any man tame him. And always night and day he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. But when he saw Jesus afar off, he ran and worshipped him and cried with a loud voice and said, What have I to do with thee, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? Now, this isn't the man saying it. This guy's full of demon. I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not. Now, you notice this seems to be a theme with demons. They know their future. For Jesus was saying to him, come out of the man, thou unclean spirit. And in that culture, like if you ask someone your name, it's even like a sign of submission. So notice these demons are submitting to Jesus, and Jesus asked them, what is thy name? And he answered, saying, my name is Legion, for we are many. And he besought him much that he would not send them away out of the country. Now there were nigh unto the mountains a great herd of swine feeding. So there's like a bunch of pigs feeding. And all the devils besought him, saying, send us into the swine that we may enter into them. So it appears to me, and probably to you too, that the demons don't like just, you know, not inhabiting a body. It seems like they don't like that. They want to inhabit something. And forthwith Jesus gave them leave. And the unclean spirits went out and entered into the swine. And so basically, it looks like Jesus tricks them here. And the herd ran violently down a steep place into the sea. So Jesus is able to save this man's life that's demon-possessed. I guess he gets the demons to come out. He gives them what they asked for. And they go into the pigs. But then the pigs, maybe they just went nuts or something, I don't know, they ran violently down a steep place into the sea. And what you have here, folks, is the very first case of deviled ham. That's what you got, the very first historic case of deviled ham. Now, there was a lot of pigs. It says there was about 2,000 of them. And they were choked in the sea. Now, can you imagine you're like the owners of the pigs? And it says, and they that fed the swine fled and told it to the city. You know, they're probably the others. And they're like, hey, you know, this guy just ruined all your pigs or whatever. And the country. And they went out to see what it was it that was done. You know, they're like, what the heck? What do you mean all the pigs went into the sea? They come to Jesus and see him that was possessed with the devil and had the legion sitting. So they see Jesus is there and he's with this guy. And the guy's there in his right mind. And so the people freak out. They're afraid. And because they know also the pigs are all dead. And they that saw it, told them how it befell to him that was possessed with the devil and also concerning the swine. And they began to pray him to depart out of their coast. They want him out of there. They're like, hey, could you leave? You know, they don't want him there. And he was coming to the ship. This part's kind of sad here. He that had been possessed with the devil prayed him that he might be with him. I mean, I'd probably be scared too. No, don't leave me. I'd be scared that those things pop back into me again or something. You know, if I was the guy, this guy there. I know I don't believe that Christians can be demon possessed. I believe they can be demon oppressed, but not possessed like this guy was. But Jesus says to him, go home to thy friends and tell them how great things the Lord hath done for thee and hath had compassion on thee. And he departed and began to publish in Decapolis how great things Jesus had done for him, and all men did marvel. And when Jesus was passed over again by ship unto the other side, here we are again. Look, he can't get any peace. It says, much people gathered unto him, and he was nigh unto the sea. And behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogues, Jairus, I believe that's how I pronounce it. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet. So you got one of the guys that's the ruler of the synagogue, and he just falls right down at Jesus' feet. He starts begging him, saying, my little daughter is lying at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her that she may be healed, and she shall live. And Jesus went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him. And a certain woman, which had an issue of blood 12 years, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had spent all that she had, you know, on cures and stuff, and was nothing bettered, but rather grew worse, when she heard of Jesus, came in the press behind and touched his garment. For she said, if I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up, and she felt in her body that she was healed of that plague. And Jesus, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, "Who touched my clothes?" Now, imagine you're Jesus' disciples and all these people are just up against you like sardines, you know, and everyone's touching them, you know, and then Jesus turns to his disciples and says, "Who touched my clothes?" What he's basically doing is Jesus knew who touched his clothes, but he's wanting this woman to come forth, because watch, he's going to show us an example here. And the disciples, so all these people are surrounding Jesus, they're up against him, they're thronging him, and his disciple, and Jesus says, "Who touched my clothes?" Right? And his disciples said unto him, "Thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, who touched me?" Like, in other words, you got to be kidding, man. What do you mean, who touched you? Look at all these people. And he looked round about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, "Daughter, thy faith had made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague." While he yet spake, there came the ruler of the synagogue's house certain, which said, "Thy daughter is dead." So Jesus didn't get there before the daughter died, right? And they're like, "Hey, don't trouble Jesus anymore. Why troublest thou the master any further?" As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, "Be not afraid, only believe." And he suffered no man to follow him, save Peter and James and John, the brother of James. And he cometh to the house. So now he's going there, and the girl's already dead, right? And it's interesting how he only chooses certain people to come with him. And he cometh to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and seeth the tumult. So, you know, you ever go to, you ever look on TV, and they'll have these funerals, especially like in the Middle East, and the women will be crying out, and even people that aren't really close to the family, a bunch of the women will get together and they'll be crying out, and you have this lamentation, right? Well, I believe that's what's happening here, and I don't think some of the people were really close to the family, but they were probably over there mourning and trying to pretend like, you know, going through the ritual of the lamentation ritual or whatever. Because look what happens here. Jesus sees all the tumult, and all the people are crying and wailing greatly, right? And when he was come in, he saith unto them, "Why make ye this ado and weep?" In other words, what are you crying for? He says, "She's not dead, she's asleep. And they laughed him to scorn. But when he had put them all out, so he says, "Look, just leave us here," and he gets rid of them all, you know, sends them out. "He taketh the father and the mother of the damsel, and them that were with him, and entereth in where the damsel was lying. And he took the damsel by the hand, and said unto her," I believe that's "Talitha kumi," which is being interpreted, "Damsel, I say unto thee, arise," or "Little girl, I say unto thee, arise." Excuse me. "And straightway the damsel arose and walked, for she was the age of 12 years. And they were astonished with a great astonishment. And he charged them straightly that no man should know it, and commanded that something should be given her to eat." So you notice Jesus, you know, knows what to do, and even says he'd give her something to eat. Mark 6. "And he went out from thence and came into his own country, and his disciples follow him. And when the Sabbath day was come, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many hearing him were astonished, saying," I guess Jesus was blowing their mind, you know, he is preaching them with authority and power, and they're astonished by his speaking. They're like, "From whence hath this man these things? Like, where did this guy learn so well? And what wisdom is this which is given unto him, that even such mighty works are wrought by his hands? Is not this the carpenter, the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and of Judah and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us?" And they were offended at him. Interesting. "But Jesus said unto them, A prophet is not without honor, but in his own country and among his own kin and his own house. And he could there do no mighty work, save that he laid his hands upon a few sick folk and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. And he went around about the villages teaching, and he called unto him the 12 and began to send them forth by two and two, and gave them power over unclean spirits, and commanded them that they should take nothing for their journey save a staff only, no scrip, no bread, no money in their purse, but be shod with sandals, and not put on two coats. And he said unto them, In what place soever you enter into a house, there abide till ye depart from that place. And what whosoever shall not receive you nor hear you when you depart. Now I want you guys to read something here. This is sweet, gentle, innocent, wonderful, loving Jesus. I want you to look what he says here. Sometimes I think people have a misunderstanding of Jesus. And look what he says. He says, And whosoever shall not receive you, nor hear you, when you depart thence, shake off the dust under your feet for a testimony against them. Look what Jesus says. It's going to shock you. Verily I say unto you, like he's like, hey, you can count on this. It shall be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city. Well, Sodom and Gomorrah was destroyed. So Jesus has a warning here for people that basically reject that message. There's no other way to read it. Notice he says, whoever shall not receive you nor hear you when you depart thence, shake off the dust under your feet. And he says, verily I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment than for that city. Notice Jesus is talking about a day of judgment. And they went out and preached that men should what? Don't judge anyone anymore. Or would they go out and preach that everyone should just accept everyone's views? No. That men should repent. There it is right there. And they cast out many devils and anointed with oil many that were sick and healed them. And King Herod heard of him, for his name was spread abroad. And he said, That John the Baptist was risen from the dead, and therefore mighty works do show forth themselves in him. So he's freaked out that it's John the Baptist. Because basically, and there's a long story, so basically Herod has John the Baptist beheaded. And I'm reading from Mark 6. You can read all that. It's a very long story. But check this out. Let's get back to where we were. Okay, here we go. And the apostles gathered themselves together unto Jesus and told him all things, both what they had done and what they had taught. And he said unto them, Come ye yourselves apart into a desert place and rest for a while. For there were many coming and going, and they had no leisure so much as to eat. So the disciples are just exhausted. And they departed into a desert place by ship privately. And the people saw them departing. And many knew him and ran afoot thither out of all the cities and out went them. They're still following Jesus. He gets no rest from these people. And Jesus, when he came out, saw much people. And look, he's not upset that they're following him, and was moved with compassion towards them. That's our Jesus, guys. Because they were a sheep not having a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. And when the day was now far spent, it's getting late, his disciples came unto him and said, you know, hey, this is a deserted place, and there's the time, it's getting late. Send them away that they may go into the country round about, into the villages, and buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat. And here goes Jesus again. Look what he says. He answered and said unto them, You give them something to eat. And they say unto him, Shall we go and buy 200 penny worth of bread and give them to eat? He saith unto them, How many loaves have ye? Go and see. And when they knew, they say, 5 and 2 fishes. And he commanded them to make all sit down by companies upon the green grass. And they sat down in ranks by hundreds and by fifties. And when he had taken the 5 loaves and the 2 fishes, he looked up to heaven and blessed and brake the loaves and gave them to his disciples to set before them. And the two fishes divided he among them all, and they did all eat, and were filled. And they took up 12 baskets full of the fragments and of the fishes, and they that did eat of the loaves were about 5,000 men. And straightway he constrained his disciples to get into the ship and go to the other side before unto Bethsaida, while he sent away the people. And when he had sent them away, he departed into a mountain to pray. And when even was come, the ship was in the midst of the sea, and he alone on the land. Okay, let me take a sip of my ice cold coffee. And he saw them toiling in rowing, for the wind was contrary unto them. And about the fourth watch of the night, he cometh unto them walking upon the sea, and would have passed by them. But when they saw him walking upon the sea, they supposed it had been a spirit and cried out. So they get kind of freaked out. They see this figure walking on the sea. For they all saw him and were troubled. And immediately he talked with them and saith unto them, Be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. And he went up and to them into the ship, and the wind ceased, and they were sore amazed in themselves beyond measure and wondered. For they considered not the miracle of the loaves, for their heart was hardened. And when they had passed over, they came into the land of Gennesaret, and drew to the shore. And when they were come out of the ship, straightway they knew him, and ran through that whole region about, and began to carry about in beds those that were sick, where they heard he was, and whithsoever he entered. So he, right when he hits ground, he's back at it again, tending to the people. They laid sick in the streets and besought him that they might touch, if it were but the border of his garment, as many as touched him were made whole. Mark 7. Then came together unto him the Pharisees and certain of the scribes which came from Jerusalem. And when they saw some of his disciples eat bread with defiled, that is to say, with unwashing hands, they found fault. For the Pharisees and all the Jews, except they wash their hands off, eat not, holding the tradition of the elders. And when they come from the market, except they wash, they eat not. And many other things there be which they receive to hold, as the washing of cups and pots, vessels, tables. Then the Pharisees and scribes asked him, Why walk not thy disciples according to the traditions of the elders, but eat bread with unwashed hands? He answered and said unto them, so Jesus says, Well hath Esaias prophesied of you hypocrites. So Jesus starts calling them hypocrites. As it is written, This people honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Howbeit in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. For laying aside the commandment of God, ye hold the tradition of men, as the washing of pots and cups, and many other such like things you do. And he said unto them, Full well you reject the commandment of God, that you may keep your own tradition. For Moses said, Honor thy father and mother, and whoso curseth father and mother, let him die the death. But you say, If a man shall say to his father and mother, It is Corban, that is to say, a gift, by whatsoever thou mightest be profited by me, he shall be free. And you suffer him no more to do aught for his father and mother, making the word of God of none effect through your tradition which you have delivered, and many such like things do ye. And when he called all the people unto him, he said unto them, Hearken unto me, every one of you, and understand. There's nothing from without a man that entering into him can defile him, but the things which come out of him, those are that they defile the man. If any man has ears to hear, let him hear. And when he was entered into the house from the people, his disciples asked him concerning the parable. And he saith unto them, Are you so without understanding also? Do you not perceive that whatsoever thing from without entereth into the man, it cannot defile him? You know, like different types of foods, you know, it's not sinful, you know, to eat certain types of food. Because it enter not into his heart, but into the belly, and go out into the drop, purging all meats. And he said, that which cometh out of the man, that defileth the man. For from within, out of the heart of men, proceed evil thoughts, adulteries, fornications, murders, thefts, covetousness, wickedness, deceit, lasciviousness, an evil eye, blasphemy, pride, foolishness. You notice Jesus doesn't believe in subjective morality. Jesus believes, obviously, in objective morality. Notice he then says, all these evil things come from within and defile the man. And from thence he arose and went into the borders of Tyre and Sidon and entered into a house and would have no man know it, but he could not be hid. He's trying to get some rest. For a certain woman whose young daughter had an unclean spirit heard of him and came and fell at his feet. The woman was a Greek, a Syrophoenician by nation, and she besought him that he would cast forth the devil out of her daughter. But Jesus said unto her, let the children first be filled, for it is not meet to take the children's bread and cast it unto the dogs. And she answered and said to him, yes, Lord, yet the dogs under the table eat of the children's crumbs. And he said unto her, for this saying, go thy way, the devil is gone out of thy daughter. And when she was come to her house, she found the devil gone out, and her daughter laid upon the bed. And again departing from the coast of Tyre and Sidon, he came into the Sea of Galilee through the midst of the coast of Decapolis. And they brought unto him one that was deaf, and had an impediment in his speech. And they beseech him to put his hands upon him. And he took him aside from the multitude, and put his fingers into his ears, and he spit and touched his tongue. And looking up to heaven, he sighed and saith unto him, Ephphatha, that is, be open. And straightway his ears were opened, and the string of his tongue was loosed, and he spake plain. And he charged them that they should tell no man, but the more he charged them, so much the more a great deal they published it, and were beyond measure astonished, saying, he hath done all things well. He make both the deaf to hear and the dumb to speak. In those days, the multitude being very great, and having nothing to eat, Jesus called his disciples unto him, and saith unto him, I have compassion on the multitude, because they have now been with me 3 days, and have nothing to eat. And if I send them away fasting to their own houses, they will faint by the way, for divers of them came from afar. And his disciples answered him, from whence can a man satisfy these men with bread here in the wilderness? And he asked them, how many loaves have ye? And they said, 7. And he commanded the people to sit down on the ground, and he took the 7 loaves, gave thanks, and brake, and gave to his disciples to set before them, and they did set them before the people. And they had a few small fishes, and he blessed and commanded to set them also before them. So they did eat, and were filled. And they took up the broken meat that was left, 7 baskets. And after they had eaten were about 4,000, and he sent them away. And they straightway entered into a ship with his disciples, and came into the parts of Dalmanutha. And the Pharisees came forth and began to question with him, seeking of him a sign from heaven, tempting him. And he sighed deeply in his spirit, and saith, why doth this generation seek after a sign? Verily I say unto you, there shall be no sign given unto this generation. And he left them, and entering into the ship again, departed to the other side. Now the disciples had forgotten to take bread, neither had they in the ship with them more than 1 loaf. And he charged them, saying, take heed, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the leaven of Herod. And they reasoned among themselves, saying, it is because we have no bread. And when Jesus knew it, he saith unto them, why reason ye because ye have no bread? Perceive ye not yet, neither understand? Have you your heart yet hardened, having eyes see not, and having ears hear ye not? And do you not remember when I break the five loaves among 5,000? How many baskets full of fragments took ye up? They say unto him, 12. And when the seven among 4,000, how many baskets full of fragments took ye up? And they said, 7. And he said unto them, How is it that you do not understand? And he cometh to Bethsaida, and they bring a blind man unto him, and he besought him to touch him. And he took the blind man by the hand, and led him out of the town. And when he had spit on his eyes, and put his hands upon him, he asked him if he saw aught. Excuse me. And he looked up and said, I see men as trees walking. After that he puts his hands again upon his eyes, and made him look up, and when he was restored and saw every man clearly. And he sent him away to his house, saying, Neither go into the town, nor tell it to any in the town. And Jesus went out and his disciples into the town of Caesarea Philippi, and by the way he asked his disciples, saying unto them, and this is important too. This is a question all of us need to answer. Jesus says, Whom do men say that I am? If Jesus was here right now in the flesh and you and I were with him and he asked this to you, whom do men say that I am? Notice he's asking what other people say about him. So they start saying what other people are saying about Jesus. And they answered John the Baptist, but some say Elias, and others one of the prophets. And he saith unto him, now notice he asks him a different question, but whom say ye that I am? Who do you say that I am? Now Peter has an epic spiritual moment here. Peter says, Thou art the Christ. And he chargeth them that they should tell no man of him. And he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and be rejected of the elders and of the chief priests and scribes and be killed and after 3 days rise again. And he spake that saying openly, and Peter took him, like basically, look, I got to talk to you. And he takes Jesus aside and he begins to rebuke Jesus. Like, no, you're not going to, you know, we're not going to let this happen to you, you know, whatever they were saying. But when he had turned about and looked on his disciples, he rebuked Peter, saying, Get thee behind me, Satan, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but the things that be of men. And when he had called the people unto him with his disciples also, he said unto them, Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. For what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Whosoever therefore shall be ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of him also shall the Son of Man be ashamed when he cometh in his glory, in the glory of his Father with the holy angels. And let it be known here for everyone on YouTube, I certainly am not ashamed at all of Jesus Christ. And he said unto them, Verily I say unto you, that there be some of them that stand here which shall not taste of death till they have seen the kingdom of God come with power. Excuse me. Let's take an ice cold coffee break here. Hold on. And after 6 days, Jesus taketh with him Peter and James and John and leadeth them up on the high mountain apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. And his raiment became shining exceeding white as snow, so as no fuller on earth can white them. And there appeared unto them Elijah with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter answered and said to Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here, and let us make three tabernacles, one for thee, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah. So basically, Peter's getting pretty emotional right now. And he's kind of like just jumping the gun here. He didn't know what to say, you know. He feels like he has to do something. He sees this epic moment. And it says right here in Scripture, "For he wist not what to say, for they were sore afraid. And there was a cloud that overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud saying, This is my beloved Son, hear him. And suddenly when they had looked round about, they saw no man any more, save Jesus only with themselves. And as they came down from the mountain, he charged them that they should tell no man what things they had seen till the Son of Man were risen from the dead. And they kept that saying with themselves, questioning one with another what the rising from the dead should mean. And they asked him, saying, Why say the scribes that Elijah must first come? And he answered and told them, Elijah verily cometh first and restoreth all things, and how it is written of the Son of Man that he must suffer many things and be set at naught. But I say unto you that Elijah is indeed come, and they have done unto him whatsoever they listed, as it is written of him. And when he came to his disciples, he saw a great multitude about them, and the scribes questioning with them. And straightway all the people, when they beheld him, were greatly amazed, and running to him, saluted him. And he asked the scribes, What question ye with them? And one of the multitude answered and said, Master, I have brought unto thee my son, which hath a dumb spirit. And wheresoever he taketh him, he teareth him, and he foameth and gnasheth with his teeth, and pinneth away. And I spake to thy disciples that they should cast him out, and they could not. So basically what you have here is this demon is pretty powerful. And notice what Jesus says. He answereth him and said, O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him unto me. And they brought him unto him, and when he saw him, straightway the spirit tear him, and he fell on the ground and wallowed foaming. So the kid's like foaming at the mouth and stuff. And he asked his father, How long is it ago since this came unto him? And he said, Of a child. And oftentimes it hath cast him into the fire and into the waters to destroy him. But if thou canst do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Jesus said unto him, If thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. And straightway the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe, help thou mine unbelief. When Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the foul spirit, saying unto them, Thou dumb and deaf spirit, I charge thee, come out of him, and enter no more into him. And the spirit cried and rent him sore, and came out of him, and he was as one dead, insomuch that many said, He is dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. And when he was come into the house, his disciples asked him privately, because they're kind of like, man, we couldn't do it. What were we doing wrong, right? Because Jesus was able to do it, right? They said, why could not we cast him out? And he said unto them, This kind can come forth by nothing but by prayer and fasting. And they departed thence and passed through Galilee, and he would not that any man should know it. For he taught his disciples and said unto them, The Son of Man is delivered into the hands of men, and they shall kill him. And after that he is killed, he shall rise the third day. But they understood not that saying, and were afraid to ask him. And he came to Capernaum, and being in the house, he asked them, What was it that you disputed among yourselves by the way? So Jesus comes in, and he asked them, What were you guys arguing about? And they're all quiet, right? They're like, How does he know, right? But they held their peace, for by the way they had disputed among themselves, look what they were arguing about, guys, who should be the greatest? In other words, who's the best? Who's going to be the greatest one in the kingdom of God? They're talking about who's the greatest, right? Now, Jesus sits down and he calls the 12. He's going to teach them something. And he said to them, If any man desire to be first, the same shall be last of all and servant of all. And he took a child and set him in the midst of them. And when he had taken him in his arms, he said unto them, Whosoever shall receive one of such children in my name receiveth me, and whosoever shall receive me receiveth not me, but him that sent me. And John answered him, saying, Master, we saw one casting out devils in thy name, and he followeth not us. And we forbade him, because he followeth not us. So basically, there's someone outside of Jesus and the disciples that is now teaching the same things Jesus is doing, but they're not part of the disciples, right? They're even using the power of Jesus Christ. And so they're saying, and we told them not to do that anymore, John answered. But Jesus said, no, forbid them not. Like, you know, let them do it. For there is no man which shall do a miracle in my name that can lightly speak evil of me. For he that is not against us is on our part. For whosoever shall give you a cup of water to drink in my name because you belong to Christ, verily I say unto you, he shall not lose his reward. Now, especially here on YouTube, there's a lot of people that are trying to turn young people away from Jesus Christ. I am literally terrified for those people on the day of judgment. Look what sweet, gentle, meek, and mild Jesus says. This is why we do not want to talk people out of following Jesus Christ. Jesus says, and whosoever shall offend one of these little ones that believe in me, he says, look, it is better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck and he were cast into the sea. And when he's saying millstone, these things are heavy. You can't even lift them. They're pretty heavy. You might be able to lift it. We should type in millstone to see. Let's type it in right now. Yeah, look. This is the millstone right here, this thing here. See if I can show you this right here. Big stone. I don't think you could lift it. But can you imagine you tie that around your neck and cast yourself into the sea? Well, this is what Jesus is saying. He says, whoever shall offend one of these little ones that believe in me, look, he says, it's better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck and he were cast into the sea. And if thy hand offend thee, he starts talking about, you know, do everything you can to avoid hell. Cut it off. It is better for thee to enter into life maimed than having two hands go into hell, into the fire that shall never be quenched, where their worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched. And if thy foot offend thee, cut it off. It is better for thee to enter halt into life than having 2 feet to be cast into hell, into the fire that never shall be quenched, where the worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched. And if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out. It is better for thee to enter into the kingdom of God with one eye than having 2 eyes to be cast into hell fire, where the worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched. For everyone shall be salted with fire, and every sacrifice shall be salted with salt. Salt is good, but if the salt have lost its saltiness, wherewith will you season it? Have salt in yourselves, and have peace with one another. And he arose from thence, and come unto the coast of Judea by the farther side of Jordan, and the people resort unto him again. And as he was wont, he taught them again. And the Pharisees came to him and asked him. Notice the Pharisees keep coming up to him, challenging him, pestering him. You notice that? And the Pharisees came to him and asked him, is it lawful for a man to put away his wife? Tempting him. And he answered and said to them, what did Moses command you? And they said, Moses suffered to write a bill of divorcement and to put her away. So in other words, they're saying, yeah, Moses said we could divorce. And Jesus answered and said unto them, for the hardness of your heart he wrote you this precept. But from the beginning of the creation God made them male and female. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife. Notice Jesus is talking about male and female. Notice that. Not two females, not two males, not notice for this cause a man shall leave his father, mother, and cleave to his wife. Notice, wife is what? Male and female. Notice, from the beginning God made them male and female. It's pretty obvious. Man marries woman. Okay. And they twain shall be one flesh. So then they are no more twain, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let no man put asunder. And in the house his disciples asked him again of the same manner. And he saith unto them, Whosoever shall put away his wife and marry another committeth adultery against her. And if a woman shall put away her husband and be married to another, she committeth adultery. And they brought young children to him that he should touch them. And his disciples rebuked those that brought them. But when Jesus saw it, he was much displeased and saith to them, Suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of God. Verily I say unto you, whosoever shall not receive the kingdom of God as a little child, he shall not enter therein. And he took them up in his arms, put his hands upon them, and blessed them. And when he was gone forth into the way, there came one running and kneeled to him and asked him, Good master, what shall I do that I may inherit eternal life? And Jesus saith to him, Why callest thou me good? There is none good but one, that is God. Thou knowest the commandments, Do not commit adultery, do not kill, do not steal, do not bear false witness, defraud not, honor thy father and mother. And he answered and said unto the master, All these I have observed from my youth. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him, and said unto him, Look, one thing thou lackest, go thy way, sell whatsoever thou hast, and give to the poor, and thou shalt have treasure in heaven. And come, take up the cross, and follow me. And he was sad at that saying, and he went away grieved, for he had great possessions. And at this time, let me drink my coffee. And Jesus looked round about and said unto his disciples, How hardly shall they that have riches enter into the kingdom of God? And the disciples were astonished at his words. But Jesus answereth again and said unto them, Children, how hard is it for them that trust in riches to enter into the kingdom of God? It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of the needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of God. And they were astonished out of measure, saying among themselves, Well, who then can be saved? And Jesus, looking upon them, saith, With men it is impossible, but not with God. For with God all things are possible. So basically, it is possible where you can be rich and you can be saved. Then Peter began to say unto him, Lo, we have left all and have followed thee. And Jesus answered and said, Verily I say unto you, there is no man that has left house, brethren, sisters, father, or mother, or wife, or children, or lands for my sake, and the gospel's, but he shall receive a hundredfold now in this time, houses, and brethren, and sisters, and mothers, and children, and lands, with persecutions. Notice he's saying, you're going to have persecutions, and in the world to come, eternal life. But many that were first shall be last, and the last first. And they were in their way going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus went before them, and they were amazed, and as they followed, they were afraid. And he took again the 12 and began to tell them what things should happen unto him, saying, Behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man shall be delivered unto the chief priest and unto the scribes, and they shall condemn him to death, and shall deliver him to the Gentiles. And they shall mock him, and shall scourge him, and shall spit upon him, and shall kill him. And on the third day he shall rise again. And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, come unto him, saying, Master, we would that thou shouldst do for us whatever we shall desire. They're basically saying, Would you give us something if we ask for it? That's what they're asking. And he said unto them, What would you that I should do for you? They said unto him, Grant unto us that we may sit one on thy right hand and the other on thy left hand in thy glory. But Jesus said unto them, basically, look, you guys don't even know what you're talking about. You don't realize the ramifications of this. He says, You know not what you ask. Can you drink of the cup that I drink of? In other words, are you willing to die? And be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? And they said unto them, We can. And Jesus said unto them, You shall indeed drink of the cup that I drink of, and with the baptism that I am baptized with shall you be baptized. But to sit on my right hand and my left hand is not mine to give, it shall be given to them for whom it is prepared. And when the ten heard it, they're like kind of ticked off at James and John. Like, I mean, they're like, dude, you know, how, I mean, I'm kind of saying it in a California way. Like, how could you ask Jesus that? I mean, you know, have some, you know, respect for Jesus. And it says, and when the ten heard it, they began to be much displeased with James and John. But Jesus called them to him and saith unto him, you know, that they which are accounted to rule over the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and their great ones exercise authority upon them. But it, so shall it not be among you. But whosoever will be great among you shall be your minister. And whosoever of you will be the chiefest shall be servant of all. See, in Jesus' point of view, in Jesus' view, the way he's looking at it is, it is the servant, it is the person that is humble and serving that is great. Jesus says, for even the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. And they came to Jericho, and as he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great number of people, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway side begging. And when they heard that it was Jesus, when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, the blind guy, he began to cry out, because he can't go to Jesus because he's blind, he can't see where he's at, so he starts yelling loud, and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And it was probably really loud and aggravating to maybe people. They didn't want Jesus, maybe they thought Jesus would get aggravated or something. And many charged him, the blind guy, that he should hold his peace. They're like, shut up, you know. But he cried the more a great deal, so he actually gets louder the more they're telling him to shut up. Thou son of David, have mercy on me, he's yelling at the top of his lungs. And Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. And they called the blind man, saying unto him, be of good comfort, rise, he calleth thee. And he, check this out right here, and he, casting away his garment. That is so beautiful right there. What this was, this garment that they had, it was like his beggar's garment. So let's say you and I were walking by in that area. The beggars would have a certain garment where you could tell that they're basically in need of money. And notice this guy, I have no doubt that he had extreme faith. He'd already heard what Jesus was doing. And he, so he's like, he's probably thinking, if Jesus ever comes through here, that's what I'm going to do. So he's casting away his garment, like his, the faith that he had is like, I'm not going to need this anymore. It's a whole new life. And he rose and he came to Jesus. And Jesus answered and said unto him, what wilt thou that I should do unto thee? The blind man said unto him, Lord, that I might receive my sight. And Jesus said unto him, go thy way, thy faith had made thee well. And immediately he received his sight, here it is, and followed Jesus in the way. And when they came nigh to Jerusalem, at the Mount of Olives, he sendeth forth two of his disciples. And he saith unto him, go your way into the village over against you, and as soon as you be entered into it, you shall find a colt tied whereon never man sat. Loose him and bring him. So there's a colt, like a donkey, that no one's ever sat on before. And he says, and if any man says unto you, why are you taking this? You know, why do you need the colt? Say that the Lord has need of him, and straightway he will send him hither. And they went their way and found the colt tied by the door without it in a place where two ways met, and they loose him. So they loosen the colt. The guy comes out and says, why are you loosing the colt? And they said unto them, even as Jesus had commanded, and they let him go. And they brought the colt to Jesus and cast their garments on him, and he sat upon him. So picture this, Jesus is now on the colt. And many spread their garments in the way, and others cut down branches off the trees and strawed them in the way. And they that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna! Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. So picture this as he's walking. It's like they're giving him the red carpet treatment as they're laying, as the colt's walking. They're giving Jesus the red carpet treatment as they're putting things in front of him, honoring him as he's walking through. And they're yelling out, Hosanna, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the kingdom of our father David that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And Jesus entered into Jerusalem and into the temple. And when he had looked round about upon all things and how the eventide was come, he went out to Bethany with the 12. And on the morrow, when they were come from Bethany, he was hungry. And seeing a fig tree afar off having leaves, he came, if haply he might find anything thereon. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves. Now, this is, I'm not going to get into this right now, but you guys should, if you do some research on this, what is the meaning of Jesus and the fig tree? See, a lot of times people just read over this, and this, there's like another hidden message in here. But let's read it. And seeing a fig tree afar off having leaves, he came, if haply he might find anything thereon. And when he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for the time of figs was not yet. And Jesus answered and said unto it, No man eat fruit of thee hereafter forever. And his disciples heard it, and they come to Jerusalem. And Jesus went into the temple and began to cast out them that sold and bought in the temple. Now Jesus goes into the temple, and he starts overthrowing the tables of the money changers, because they're turning it into like a merchandising enterprise, you know. And would not suffer that any man should carry any vessel through the temple. And he taught, saying unto them, Is it not written, My house shall be called of all nations the house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves? And the scribes and chief priests heard it, and sought how they might destroy him, for they feared him, because of all the people were astonished at his doctrine. And when evening was come, remember the fig tree, right? He went out of the city, and in the morning as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up from the roots. Now, I'm not going to tell you what that means. There's a reason behind that. So we'll leave you in suspense on that, but there's a little secret message there. And Peter, calling to remembrance, said unto him, Master, behold the fig tree which thou cursed, it withered away. And Jesus answering said unto them, Have faith in God, for verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, Be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Therefore I say unto you, What things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you shall have them. And when you stand praying, forgive, if you have aught against any, that your Father also which is in heaven may forgive you of your trespasses. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive your trespasses. And they come upon again to Jerusalem, and as he was walking in the temple, there come to him the chief priests. Oh, and this is one of my favorite passages here. I even use this when I'm debating atheists and stuff in my chat room. It's really good. And they come again to Jerusalem, and he was walking in the temple. There come to him the chief priests and the scribes and the elders, and say unto him, By what authority dost thou these things? And who gave thee this authority to do these things? Notice they're questioning Jesus. Now, Jesus doesn't meekly say, Well, let me just bow down to you and let me answer all your questions. You know, look what Jesus says. And this is actually good. I use this. I'm certainly not comparing myself to Jesus in any way. But the method that he uses when he's conversing with people, and if you're conversing with unbelievers, you have the right to ask them questions too. So look what Jesus says. He says they just they're like basically confronting him, and they're like shooting all these questions at him, right? And Jesus answered and said unto them, I will also ask of you one question, and answer me, and I will tell you by what authority I do these things. In other words, he's like, okay, if you're willing to have like an open conversation, you answer my question, I'll answer yours. You see how that is? Now watch. Jesus puts them in their place. This is epic. Remember, excuse me, remember, and then I'm going to have to end this video, guys, because my throat's wearing out. And I got to go to work tomorrow. But I will finish, I'll finish, Mark. I won't leave you guys hanging. I'll pick up this video again. But I want to show this to you here. Remember, l let's look at what happened here. It says, the chief priest and the scribes and the elders. Who are these dudes? Well, these are the people that didn't really like John the Baptist. So, but the people love John the Baptist, you know. They really believe that he's a prophet. So what Jesus does, let me start over. They come to Jesus Christ, so what authority do you do these things? And who gave you this authority? And Jesus boldly says, I will also ask you one question, and answer me, and I will tell you by what authority I do these things. The baptism of John, Jesus says, was it from heaven or of men? Now you might be saying, well, that's an easy question, but watch, not for this, the priests, the scribes, and the elders. So watch this. Jesus says, the baptism of John, was it from heaven or of men? Answer me. And they reasoned with themselves, saying, they're like in a huddle, probably, right? Well, if we say from heaven, he'll say, well, then why did you not believe him? Because they were like basically mocking John, and they didn't like him, they didn't support him. But if we shall say of men, they feared the people. For all men counted John that he was a prophet indeed. So look what they do. They're not going to answer him. And they answered and said to Jesus, "We cannot tell." Like, well, we're not going to tell you what we don't know. And Jesus answered them, saying, "Neither do I tell you by what authority I do these things." He got him. That was good. Okay, let me just read one more page. I can't stop. And he began to speak unto them by parables. A certain man planted a vineyard. Oh, and by the way, this is a great parable if you're witnessing to Muslims, because this clearly shows that Jesus Christ is referring to himself as the Son of God, not just some prophet. So listen. And he began to speak unto them by parables. A certain man planted a vineyard, and set a hedge about it, and digged a place for the wine fat, and built the tower, and let it out to husbandmen. So basically, the guy owns a vineyard, and he hires some workers to take care of it while he's gone. And he went off into a far country. And at the season, he sent to the husbandmen a servant. I mean, the servants represent prophets of God in this parable, right? That he might receive from the husbandmen of the fruit of the vineyard. But the husbandmen, they caught him and beat him and sent him away empty. And again, he sent them another servant. So the vineyard owner sends another servant, another prophet, right? And at him they cast stones and wounded him in the head and sent him away shamefully handled. And again, he sent another. And him they killed, and many others, beating some and killing some. Having yet therefore one son, Jesus is clearly, obviously, everyone reading this knows that he's referring to himself. Jesus is the son in this parable. Watch. Having yet therefore one son, his well-beloved, he sent him also last unto them, saying, they will reverence my son. But those husbandmen said among themselves, this is the heir, come, let us kill him, and the inheritance shall be ours. And they took him and killed him and cast him out of the vineyard. And then Jesus says, what shall therefore the Lord of the vineyard do? He will come and destroy the husbandmen, and will give the vineyard unto others. And have you not read this scripture? The stone which the builders rejected is become the head of the corner. This was the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Now, you see what Jesus is going through here? He says that to them, and guys, they get ticked off. Look what happened. It's like he's shooting arrows right into their heart, and they get convicted. They flip out. It says, and they sought to lay hold on him. They wanted to get Jesus. But they feared the people, for they knew that he had spoken the parable against them. See, Jesus is referring to himself as the Son, and the husbandmen are basically these religious people beating up the prophets of God as throughout history. And they left him and went their way. And when I'm done here, I'm going to go heat up my coffee. And then I got to go to sleep. I drink coffee right before I go to sleep. And by the way, guys, I really do. If you guys are still listening, this is like a really long video. I really appreciate it. And I'll keep doing these. Even if no one listens to them, I like reading them. Okay, so where are we at, guys? Oh, here it is. And so they went away. Okay, and they send unto him certain of the Pharisees and of the Herodians to catch him in his words. Oh, this is funny. My mom and I always tease my mom about this. And when they were there, come, they say unto him, Master, we know that thou art true and carest for no man, for thou regardest not the person of men, but teachest the way of God in truth. Is it lawful to give tribute to Caesar or not? Shall we give or shall we not give? So basically, you know, taxes. Should we pay taxes to Caesar or not? You know. But he, knowing their hypocrisy, said unto them, Why tempt ye? Bring me a penny that I may see it. And they brought it, and he said unto them, basically, whose picture's on here? Who is this image and the superscription? And they said unto him, Caesar's. And Jesus answering said unto them, Render to Caesar's the things that are Caesar's, and to God the things that are God. And that answer blew them away, and they marveled at him. You know what I always tell my mom every time? Because over here in California, we have to pay state and federal taxes. I'm like, oh, I got to pay taxes again. And my mom always goes, she'll say, well, remember, you know, you got to render to Caesar what is Caesar. I go, well, where's Caesar? He's dead. Where is Caesar? If I knew where he was, no, I'm kidding. Okay, so where were we at? Okay, here we go. They keep trying to trick Jesus. Then come unto him the Sadducees, which say there is no resurrection. And they asked him, saying, Master, the Sadducees don't believe in the resurrection, right? So they want to try to prove to Jesus that the resurrection is illogical. And at first it seems, you're like, yeah, how's Jesus going to answer that? But then Jesus answers it truthfully, and you realize that it's the Sadducees which are illogical. Watch. The Sadducees want to prove that the resurrection of life is not real. So they come to Jesus Christ, and they say, Master, here's the deal. Moses wrote unto us, if a man's brother die and leave his wife behind and leave no children, that his brother should take his wife and raise up seed unto his brother. So in other words, in Moses' law, if there's a husband and wife married and the husband dies, the brother of the one that died can marry the wife and they can get married and have kids, right? But so they give Jesus this story, and they said, but what happened is there were seven brothers. They like make it up, but it's like it's an analogy. And the first took a wife, and dying left no seed. So the first husband's like dead, right? The second marries her and dies, and they don't have any kids either. And third, after a while, I'd be like, well, why would you keep marrying this woman? Something's fishy. No, I'm just kidding. But basically, they're asking him, she's been married three times, right? And then they go through the whole thing, and the seven had her. Now she's been married seven times. So basically, all seven husbands die, I guess, in this analogy they're giving them. Now here's the question. And it's a good question, they ask her. And they don't have any kids. Last of all, the woman died also. The woman's like, yeah, I'm out of here too. So they ask Jesus in the resurrection, here's the trick question here, when they rise, whose wife shall she be? Good question, right? For the seven had her as a wife. Now, Jesus clears things up here because Jesus knows what heaven is like. They don't. And Jesus answering said unto them, do you not therefore err? Like, look, don't you understand you're making a mistake? Because you know not the scriptures, neither the power of God. For when they shall rise from the dead, they neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are as the angels which are in heaven. And as touching the dead that they rise, have you not read in the book of Moses how in the bush God spake unto him, saying, I am the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. Because see, they're over these Sadducees are talking about dead, this person's dead, that person's dead. They don't get it. Look what Jesus says. He says, look, let's go back there. Where was I at here? Okay, here it is. Jesus says, look, he's not the God of the dead, but the God of the living. They're alive. You therefore do greatly err, Jesus says. And one of the scribes came and having heard them reasoning together and perceiving that he had done well, they're like, man, that was an epic answer, Jesus. That's true. So they said to Jesus, which is the first commandment of all? And Jesus answered him, saying, the first of all the commandments is, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment. And the second is like it, namely this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is none other commandment greater than these. And the scribe said unto him, Well, master, thou hast said, none other commandment greater than these. So the guy is like, yeah, you know what? That's true, you know. And the scribe said unto him, Well, master, thou hast said the truth, for there is one God, and there is none other but he, and to love him with all the heart, and with all the understanding, with all the soul, and with all the strength, and to love his neighbor as himself is more than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices. And when Jesus saw that he answered discreetly, in other words, his heart's right. You see that? Isn't it? There's something really good and happy when someone's got a good right heart for God. I love that. It's just like when time and the spirit and the person and their heart all comes together in one, and it all lines up right, and we choose to have a good right heart for God. It's awesome. And Jesus sees that this guy's heart's right, and he says, notice it says, and when Jesus saw that he answered discreetly, he said unto him, Thou art not far from the kingdom of God. And no man after that durst ask him any question. And Jesus answered and said, while he taught in the temple, How say the scribes that Christ is the son of David? For David himself said by the Holy Ghost, The Lord said to my Lord, Sit thou on my right hand till I make thine enemies thy footstool. David therefore himself calleth him Lord, and whence is he then his son? Like, how could he be a son if he's calling him Lord? And the common people heard him gladly. And he said unto them in his doctrine, Beware of the scribes, which love to go in long clothing, and love salutations in the marketplaces, and the chief seats in the synagogues, and the uppermost rooms at feast, which devour widows' houses, and for a pretense make long prayers, these shall receive greater damnation. And Jesus sat over against the treasury and beheld, and this is a really good story. This is a good one to end it on. And I do appreciate you guys listening to it. And by the way, may God bless you richly and greatly. I hope this has been a blessing to you. Listening to this, you can go right below this video, go to shotgunnow.net, and you could download these Bibles and readings in audio. There's one done by a really good pastor, And if you, it's kind of like what I'm doing here, except better. Better than I could do. But if you click below this video and go to shotgunnow.net and click entire audio, it goes through it and it's excellent. You guys will like it. And you know, what's really good about the Bible is you really get blessed. It's an instant 100% sure blessing. It's spiritual food. And so let's talk about one of my favorite stories. I have to tell you about this, not to get all melodramatic on you, but there was a lady that I used to work with. She was not a Christian, and I was witnessing to her and talking to her, and I told her about this story here because she's like, oh, I don't understand the Bible, and she didn't really read it, you know. And when I told her about this story here, her eyes welled up with tears, and it's not really like that of an emotional story, but it really touched her because maybe she was going through some financial times, hard times at that moment, and I could tell that it really struck with her. So, well, let me read it to you. Like, I think you'll enjoy this. It's basically going to explain how God sees the heart, not outward appearance or clothing or automobiles, money or anything like that. It says, and the chief priests, okay, we covered that. And Jesus sat over against the treasury, so where people come in and give money to the church, the temple. And he beheld how the people cast money into the treasury, and many that were rich cast in much. So people put lots of money in there, lots. So you picture all these real rich people dressed up real nice, and here comes this raggedy old widow. And there came a certain poor widow, this woman, and she threw in two mites, which is like probably equivalent to like a penny today or whatever, which make a farthing. And he called unto him his disciples. So he draws attention to this woman. You notice he's not drawing attention to all the other people. He stops and he draws attention to this woman. And this is, I know I say epic a lot when I'm reading the Bible, but it's so epic. And he says unto his disciples, hey, look, verily I say unto you that this poor widow hath cast more in than all they which have cast into the treasury. What Jesus is saying is what she gave was more than everyone else combined. He says, because for all they did cast in of their abundance, but she of her want did cast in all she had, even all her living. That is epic, isn't it? And I love you guys. God bless you. Don't forget to go to, let me give you my website here. And what you can do is you can go to shotgunnow.net, which you're looking at right now, and we're right here. You want to click free audio Bible, and you can listen to the Bible. And also, if you want it on video, where you can hear some good Christian music, good musicians, and be taught from a church, go to Live Church. God bless you guys. Have a great week. Isn't that an epic? Again, with the epic. If you guys want that graphic, I think you just right click on it. You can save it, but it's Jesus. And he's carrying the sin of the world, and it says, bench press this Satan. God bless you guys. I love you. This is Shock, and have a great week.